Hi, this is Jayanti. Today I am here to discuss about the parameters of overhead transmission line. Already on the last four sessions, I have discussed how to calculate the resistance and inductance of overhead transmission line. But today I am going to focus mainly on the calculation of capacitance of overhead transmission line. Why this capacitance of overhead transmission line is occurring here? We know that there is a potential difference between the conductors of the overhead transmission line, and thereby the capacitance is arising. And this capacitance with the shunt conductance forms the shunt admittance. As this shunt conductance is arising in the overhead transmission line, due to the leakage current flowing over the surface of the insulator, and as the leakage current is much smaller compared to the main current flowing through the transmission line, that is the series current flowing through the transmission line. So this leakage current can be ignored and thereby the shunt conductance can be neglected. Okay, but here the capacitance, which one is proportional to the length of the transmission line, cannot be ignored here. And while the AC supply is given across the overhead transmission line, then this shunt capacitance will draw a line charging current. This line charging current is huge under the no load or the light load condition of the long transmission line. And thereby the receiving end voltage is greater than sending end voltage, which one is called the Ferranti effect. Now, let's see what are the several cases we will study here. We have to study here calculate the capacitance of single phase overhead transmission line. Next, capacitance of three phase overhead transmission line. It may be single circuit or it may be double circuit. We have to compare in between them which one is more advantageous. That's by calculating in terms of capacitance. Next one is the bundle conductor. Already on the last session I have discussed bundle conductors is much more effective in the extra high voltage line where the corona loss is reduced and the transmission capacity is increased. Next one is the effect of earth on the capacitance of transmission line. Now see here the conductors are a height, appreciable height from the ground or the earth. Then the effect of earth can be ignored. But if the capacitance conductors are near the earth, then the effect of earth cannot be ignored because it distorts the electric field lines of the conductor itself. So we have to consider their effect of earth also. Next, before going to the calculation of capacitance of overhead transmission line, it's much more essential to know about the electric field and potential difference. We know that an electric charge surrounding it exerts a force on any other charge if it's placed on that region. So that region on which the first charge will exert force on any other charge is called the electric field of the first charge. And what's the electric field intensity or strength? That one is nothing but the force per unit charge. The unit of electric field intensity will be Newton per Coulomb or volt per meter. Now, let us consider a line having infinite length, supposed to say, there are x, y, z axes, and that is there is a line having the infinity length. And having the charge uniformly distributed along the along z axis, which one is rho L Coulomb per meter, which one is rho L Coulomb per meter, which one is distributed along the along z axis. Now, supposed to say we have to find out the electric field intensity at point P. Electric field intensity at point P, which one is at a distance rho, which one is at a distance rho from the central axis of the conductor. This one is direction of electric field intensity, which one is radial, okay, and along the rho direction. So what we have to do here, according to Gauss's law, we know that we have to consider here one Gaussian surface, which one is also cylindrical and symmetric about the z-axis. Which one is cylindrical and symmetric about z-axis and passing through point P. Passing through point P, this one is the Gaussian surface, right? And see here, this Gaussian surface has three surface areas, top surface, bottom surface, and this one is the cylindrical surface, area of the Gaussian surface, that is ds3, having the direction same as E vector. We know that always the electric field lines originate from the positive charge and terminate at the negative charge, and always the equipotential surfaces are orthogonal to the electric field lines. Okay. Next. And that's why the D vector or the E vector, if we are considering here, D vector, which one is constant for over the Gaussian surface. Now see, from the Gaussian surface, we can write here, if length of the Gaussian surface can be written as small l, then the charge enclosed by this Gaussian surface can be written as rho l into n, and this d vector can be written as d a rho, that is having only the a rho direction. Next, from the Gauss's law, we can write here q enclosed equals to rho L into L equals to closed surface integral, of D vector. As see here, closed surface integral of D vector, that is having the three surfaces DS1, DS2, DS3, and that one is the dot product here, right? And as DS1 is perpendicular to D vector, DS2 is again perpendicular to the E vector or D vector. So that two are the product of DS1 and D vector will be zero. Product of DS2 and D vector will be zero. So it's having only the rho direction. So here we can write this vector as dA rho DS3 having the direction A rho, because it's always the direction of surface is always in the outer direction and normal to the surface. So it will be ultimately d into ds3. ds3 is nothing but 2 pi rho into l. So what's the expression for d? Here? Rho l divided by 2 pi rho. But rho l is nothing but the charge per unit length. And this rho is nothing but the distance from the central axis of the conductor. And as this D vector is having no Z direction, so here in vector form it can be written as rho L divided by 2 pi rho into A rho, and E vector can be written as D by epsilon naught, that is rho L divided by 2 pi epsilon naught into rho A rho. The unit of it is volt per meter. Unit of E vector is volt per meter. Now I am clearing all the drawing here. So electric field intensity can be written as E vector equals to Q by 2 pi epsilon rho into A rho. Now consider here, there is a one charge, that is Q charge, positive charge, we have to find out the potential difference between points x1 and x2, where x1 is at distance d1 and x2 is distance d2 from the center of the conductor, right? Then what will be the expression for it? We know that the unit of effector is volt per meter, so we have to multiply it with meter. That is, potential difference between two points can be written as the work done to move that positive charge from the potential having from the point having lower potential to the point having higher potential. That is E vector dot D rho vector. Actually, V12 is nothing but the work done to move the charge from the point having lower potential, that is D2, to D1. And as we have to move the charge against the electric field, that's why the negative sign is arising here. And after that, here V12 equals to E vector dot D rho vector having integration of limit D1 to D2. And this one ultimately gives us Q by 2 pi epsilon naught ln D2 by D1, where D2 is greater than D1 and D2 is having the lower potential compared to the point having, that is x1, having higher potential. That means, yeah, we can write that one as Vx1 greater than Vx2. That one is a generalized expression for one charge. Next, potential differences in an array of solid cylindrical conductors. Now, let's consider there are n number of charges. Let's consider there are n number of charges having uniformly distributed charge There are n number of charges. Now, and the negligible distortion means we are assuming here the distance of the conductors is much more compared to their radius. And the height of the conductor from the ground is much more, such that here the distortion can be ignored due to the earth effect and due to the another conductor also. And the summation of all the charges equal to zero. Then, suppose to say we have to find out here the potential difference between conductors K and I. Potential difference between conductors K and I due to QM charge. By applying the previous expression, supposed to say the distance between these two conductors can be written as dIm. This one can be written as dKm. QK is at higher potential and QY is comparatively at lower potential compared to QK. Then what will be the formula? Already we have derived that one. Just by applying the previous expression, VKI, that is the potential difference between the points K and I, potential difference between the points K and I due to this charge QM, QM divided by 2 pi epsilon naught ln DIM divided by DKM. DIM, here QY is at lower potential, that's why it will be numerator DIM divided by DKM. Which one is at lower, higher potential comparatively. Okay, now this one is only for QM charge. So what will be the expression for of the VKI for all the charges, we have to apply here the superposition theorem. The potential difference between the conductors K and I due to all the charges will be one by 2 pi epsilon naught summation m equals to 1 to a qm ln dim divided by dkm. And what's epsilon? We know that one is the permittivity having the value. Epsilon is the permittivity of the free space having the value 8.854 into 10 to the power minus 12 farad per meter. This one is the generalized expression for the potential difference between conductors K and I due to all charges. That is VKI equals to 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught summation m equals to 1 to n qm ln dim divided by dkm. That is the second suffix will be in numerator and the first suffix will be in denominator, that is K. And here the second suffix corresponds to the suffix of the charge, that is the qm. Next, consider here the capacitance of single phase transmission line. For capacitance of single phase transmission line, consider there are two conductors. Consider there are two conductors having uniformly distributed charge. That is, this one is supposed to be conductor 1, that is 2. Here that one is Q1, that one is Q2. And radii is R1, that one is R2. And the distance between the center of two conductors can be written as capital D. Here we are assuming here D is much, much greater compared to R1 and R2, such that here the electric field of the second conductor, the presence of the second conductor cannot disturb the electric field of the first conductor. And as the conductors are, we are assuming here the conductors are much above the ground or the earth. That's why the effect of the earth can be ignored here. Now, we have to calculate here the potential difference between these two conductors. That is, we have to calculate here V12 just by applying the generalized expression. We have to calculate here V12. That is the potential difference between two conductors. How it can be written? That one is a generalized expression, that is 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught summation m equals to 1 to 2 qm. Qm is the charge here, ln d2m, that is the second suffix will be numerator, d2m divided by d1m equals to 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught, first one is the charge 1, q1, ln d21 divided by d11. Just I am showing it clearly. Second one is plus q2 ln d22 by d12. Just see here, d11, d22, that are nothing but the radius of the conductor. Here we can write d11 equals to d22. It's nothing but the d11 equals to r1 actually. Which one we have assumed for this case, d11 equals to r1 and d22 equals to r2, that is the radius of the second conductor. And here the mutual distance d12 is equal to d21. So we have right here q1 ln d21, that is d by r1, plus q2 ln d22 by d12, that is r2 by d. And there is another assumption, that is under balanced condition, q1 plus q2 equals to 0. That means here q2 can be written as minus q1. That's why here we have taken minus sign, that is ln divided by ln r2 divided by t. So by simplifying further, v12 can be written as 2q1 divided by 2 pi epsilon naught ln d by r1 r2. 2q1 divided by 2 pi epsilon naught ln d divided by not r1 r2. That one will be actually root over r1 r2. That one is equal to q1 divided by 2 pi epsilon naught ln d square divided by r1 r2. Now while we are considering two outside of ln, then it will be ln d divided by root over r1 r2. That one is equal to q1 divided by pi epsilon naught ln d divided by root over r1 r2 equals to q1 divided by pi epsilon naught ln d by r. Or if the two conductors are identical or having the equal radii, that is r1 equals to r2 equals to r, then only we can write this expression q1 divided by pi epsilon naught ln d by r. But it's a normal practice to represent the transmission line on per phase basis, right? So we have to express this capacitance in terms of between the two conductors of single phase line, first one, then we have to convert it into the capacitance between the conductor and neutral. So what will be the expression for capacitance between two conductors? That is nothing but we know the expression, that is C equals to Q by V. C equals to Q by V. So Q1 divided by V12, C12 equals to Q by V, Q1 divided by V12, that one is equal to pi epsilon naught divided by ln d by r, and by putting all the values here, we'll have 0.0121 divided by log d by r. So capacitance between each conductor and neutral can be written as, just see here, the conductors is like that. This is normal practice to present the to model the transmission line in per phase basis. That is conductor one, that is conductor two, that one is N, that is C1N, that one is C2N, and here as V1N equals to V2N equals to half of V12. So here capacitance will be doubled. V1N equals to V2N equals to half of V12. So what will be the expression for C1N? That will be nothing but C equals to Q by V, that is Q, Q1 divided by V1N. So it will be doubled of C12. So C1N equals to C2N equals to 0.0242. divided by log d by r. And what's the expression for line charging current? IC equals to voltage by capacitive admittance, not capacitive, voltage by impedance, that one, that is the V12 into j omega C12. Okay, V12 into j omega C12, or voltage into admittance, capacitive admittance. So I am clearing all the pictures here. This one is a generalized expression for line charging current of the single phase transmission line, that is IC equals to j omega C12 V12, voltage into admittance. Next, consider capacitance of three phase transmission line. We are going to discuss here mainly about the transpose transmission line. We know the configuration of the transpose transmission line. Just like that, supposed to say here A, B, C phases are here. This one is section one, section two. This one is section three. position 1 to 3. For section 2, what will be the position of A? It will be shifted by 1. B will be shifted by 1 and it will occupy position 3. C will shift it by 1 and it will occupy position 1. For section 3, what is happening here? 2 is shifted by 1 and it will occupy position 3. 1 will occupy position 2 and 3 will occupy position 1. Just like that. Now, for simplicity, I am considering here only the section 1 first to find out the capacitance of 3-phase transmission line. Suppose to say there are the conductors of phase A, B and C having the charges QA, QB and QC. For the first section, the distance between QA and QB can be written as D12. This one is 1, 2, 3. This one is D23. This one is D31. For the first case, we are considering only section 1 here. Then we'll consider all the rest of the sections for a complete transposed cycle to calculate the capacitance of 3-phase transposed cycle. So for balanced 3-phase system, we know that here the summation of all the charges present in the 3 phases, that is QA plus QB plus QC equals to 0 for balanced 3-phase system. And we have to find out first of all potential difference between phase A and B. So we are considering here section 1 first. We are considering here section 1 first, right? So what will be the expression here? VAB1. That is the potential difference between phases A and B for section 1 can be written as just by applying the generalized expression 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught. I am showing the generalized expression again. That is VAB can be written as 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught summation N equals to 1 to 3 because there are 3 conductors in 3 phases. Okay. Summation 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught V by summation M equals to 1 to 3 QM LN. This one will be DBM divided by DAM. DBM divided by DAM. Just see here. While we are considering QA, that is QA, LN, DBM. DBM means that one will be DBA. And what is the expression for DBA? Just I am showing it in detail. That can be written as 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught QA, LN, DBA divided by DAA, QB LN DBB divided by DAB plus QC LN DBC divided by DAC. Right. Now see here. 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught QA LN DBA. DBA means that one is D12. DAA is nothing but the radius of the conductor itself. That one is R here. Plus QB LN DBB again R divided by DAB. DAB means D12. Plus QC LN DBC. DBC means D23. Divided by DSC. DSC that is D31. LN D23 divided by D31. So for first session, the potential difference between the conductors or between the phases A and B can be simplified as this expression. Next we are considering here the potential difference between phases A and B for section 2 and section 3. We are considering here the potential difference between the phases A and B for section 2. For section 2, what is happening here? The conductor A will occupy the position of conductor B now. B is occupying the position of C now, and C is occupying the position of A now. And again, by applying the generalized expression, we'll have 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught qa ln d23 divided by r dr. That is, again, considering here the generalized expression, that is, VAB can be written as 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught summation m equals to 1 to 3 um ln dBm divided by dAm. That means 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught qa ln dBa divided by dAa. That one will be dA. qb ln dBb by dAb plus qc ln dBc divided by dAc. Right. Now put here this expression as, what will be the generalized expression? This one is the generalized expression, and by putting all the values here, 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught qa ln dBa. What's the value here now? dBa means nothing but d23 divided by dA, that is r, plus qb ln dBb, that is the radius of the conductor in phase B, r, divided by dAb. dAb is again d23 now, plus qc ln dBc. dBc is now d31, and divided by dAc. dAc is now d12. dAc is now d12. This one is the potential difference between phases A and B for section 2. Now, what will be the potential difference between phases A and B for section 3? Again, one more shifting will be there. Just I am showing it. A is occupying position of B. A is occupying now for section 3 position of B. B is occupying now position of C. And C is occupying the position of A. For the third section, that will be the configuration. That one is the configuration now. So what will be the expression for potential difference between phases A and B for section 3? 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught qa ln dBa. What is the value of dBa now? That is d31 divided by dAa by r, plus qb ln dBb, that is the radius of the conductor itself, dAb. dAb is d31. Plus QC ln dBc. ln dBc means dBc is d12 divided by dAc. Divided by dAc. AC means d23. Right. These are the expressions for potential difference between phases A and B for the three sections. So by adding and taking the average of these three expressions, we will have the potential difference, average potential difference. Average value of the potential difference between phase A and B will be just like that. One third of we have to take the average of all the values here. And after simplifying these, it will be 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught Q by ln D12 D23 into D31. There is one third. It will be here to the power one third divided by R cube to the power one third. That will be R. Plus QB again R cube to the power one third. That will be R. D12 D23 D31 to the power one third. And QC into ln D12 D23 D D12 D23 D31 divided by D12 D23 D31. That is the ln 1 will be 0. So it will be the ultimate expression here, 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught QA ln D equivalent by R plus QB ln R by D equivalent. The D equivalent is nothing but D12 D23 D31 to the power 1 third. So potential difference between phase A and B can be written as 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught QB ln D equivalent by R plus QB ln R by D equivalent. That is the mutual GMD here. Similarly, the potential difference between phase A and C can be written as VS equals to 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught QA ln D equivalent by R plus QC ln R by D equivalent. Now, just by adding, what is happening here? We know that VAB is nothing but VA minus VB. VAB is nothing but VAN minus VBN plus VAC can be written as VAN minus VCN. And at the balanced condition, all the three phase voltages are having the equal magnitude but 120 degree displaced from each other. If that one is neutral point, that one is VAN, VBN, VCN or VA, VB, VC. 120 degree displaced from each other. If we are taking here VA, or VAN as the reference phasor, then with respect to VN, we can write VB, VBN as alpha square VAN, and VCN can be written as alpha VN, where alpha is nothing but having magnitude 1 and angle 120 degree, which one is the complex operator. That can be written as 2 VAN, that is nothing but actually 3VAN. And that is a general simplified expression that is 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught just by adding these two formulas. 1 by 2 pi epsilon naught QA ln D equivalent by R whole square plus QB plus QC ln R by D equivalent. QB plus QC is nothing but minus QA. So it will be ultimately, we know that under balanced condition, QA plus QB plus QC equals to 0. So here QB plus QC can be written as minus QA, right? So by including the negative sign here, it will be ln D equivalent by R. So ultimately it will be 3 QA divided by 2 pi epsilon naught ln D equivalent by R, which is nothing but 3 VAN, which is nothing but 3 VAN. This one is 3VAN. And just by equating the above two for the previous formula with that one, VN will be QA divided by 2 pi epsilon naught ln D equivalent by R. So capacitance power phase to neutral of transpose transmission line can be written as CN equals to QA divided by VN just by applying QA divided by V, Q by V. CAN equals to Q by divided by VA, that is 2 pi epsilon naught divided by ln T equivalent by R, and which is nothing but 0.0242 divided by log D equivalent by R. Now, this one is for transpose transmission line having the unequal spacing. If for equilateral spacing, what is happening there? For equilateral spacing, what is happening there? We know that D12 equals to D23 equals to D31. If it may be considered as D, then it will be 0.0242 log D by R, because D equivalent is nothing but D12, D23, D31 to the power 1/3. So it will be, for equilateral spacing, it will be D cube to the power 1/3, which one is nothing but D. So it will be log D by R, 0.0242 divided by log D by R. That is the capacitance per phase to neutral of transpose transmission line. That one is the formula, and for equilateral spacing, that one is the formula, 0.0242 divided by log D by R. And what's the expression for line charging current? That is nothing but the product of admittance with the voltage per phase, that is VLN into J omega CAN. That is the line charging current. And that's all about today's session.